look for the kinds of illustrations and graphics and charts that show how the underlying surface is associated to the above the surface features. Here's an ice surface from Mars, the base of the polar ice, how tall it is, and the different kinds of ice that are in that. Here is a graphic of Titan that shows the smooth and the rough terrain, trying to bring that out. This is a colorized image of this black and white one. The brighter is the more complicated, rough, broken terrain, and then the green represents the smooth areas. Here is a graphic of Europa that shows underneath the surface how the cold water, the warm ice, the dikes, the diaper, the ocean, how they those features below the surface look and what you see above the surface. So maybe here we have warm rising water or slush that's producing that dome. Okay, so look for those kinds of things. We're interested in the processes that formed the features. And of course, it's all done with remote sensing. We remote sense everything on Earth. It's much easier to go up and look down and study phytoplankton in the ocean than to go out there and try to cover the ocean with a gazillion boats studying phytoplankton. So we study the Earth constantly for everything imaginable, and that's the same kinds of instrumentation that we use to image features on planets and moons to collect data from them. This one, for instance, is a neutron density map on Mars. Well, neutron density, looking for hydrogen, and hydrogen is a big part, of course, of H2O. So that will show you where it's most likely to have water. So find all of these different interesting kinds of information data, because you will be doing interpretive tasks to put these things together. Also, physical, thermal, and chemical properties of habitable zones, places where some kind of living organisms can arise. For instance, one of the extraterrestrial planets, Gliese 581g, is of great interest because it's sort of Earth-sized. It's right smack dab in the middle of the habitable zone for Gliese 581. And as Earth is in the habitable zone, as is Mars, and Venus is sort of half in and half out. Now, and if you, you know, it's like, well, we've already got a pretty good idea of what's out there. We're pretty sure that at those extreme environments that we're not going to find anything living. Well, that's not true, because we have extremophilic life forms right here on Earth. We have microbes that love the cold, that love the heat, that love radiation, that love salt, that love dry, that love extremely acidic environments, that love extremely basic environments. We even have little critters that have no fear of extreme gravity. You know, they've taken some microbes and whirled them around at 200,000 Gs. Now, 50 or 60 is fatal to me, for me, but those little buggers, you know, got out of that centrifuge and just went off like they had just gotten off a carousel ride in the park. Just another day at the circus. So we have extremophiles everywhere, and we have them right here on Earth. Now, there are a lot of photos of Yellowstone National Park, and it looks like it very well could be the surface of some other planet far, far away. Very alien-looking environment. Very extreme-looking environment. And this is a NASA astrobiologist who is studying little microbes in Yellowstone National Park that love to live in 175 degrees Fahrenheit. And they also study little critters that like to live, especially in these little bubbling mud pots in Yellowstone National Park. This is Scott Anderson. He's an astrobiologist for SETI, and he's in Antarctica in Lake Untersee, And he spends and has spent a lot of his time scuba diving down into this lake in Antarctica, which it is said, the best description I've read is like swimming in a bottle of Clorox. It's really, really seriously basic. Very strong. And just below freezing. But down there, guess what? Layer upon layer, it is littered with microbial mats. Mats of microbes that are living in a bottle of Clorox at just above freezing in Antarctica.